Hello all, welcome back to VTO eShikshana program. I, Dr. Susmita Mahapatra, is here to take the class from the second module of microwave and antennas, which is microwave network theory and microwave passive devices. Now, in last class, we have already discussed some of the differences between a general network, a normal network, and a microwave network. And we saw that in a normal network, we can just talk regarding the network, or we can specify the network in terms of input voltage, output voltage, input current, and output current, where we have a relationship between voltage and current at the input port and at the output port in terms of Z parameter, Y parameter, H parameter, and ABCD parameter. But when you come to a microwave network, it is not just in the terms of voltage or current, rather it is in terms of a microwave signal. So when we consider a signal, a wave, we have to consider the incident wave, we have to consider the reflected wave, because in a microwave network theory, that microwave network, there can be different discontinuities because of the network features, because of the mismatch of impedance. So because of all these things, we have the reflected wave. Now when we have a microwave two-port network or multi-port network, we have to get a relationship between this input wave, that is your incident wave, and the reflected wave. Now this relationship, we discussed that we can have it in terms of scattering parameter, that is known as S parameter. So in today's class, let us find out a solution for a microwave network, how we can represent a microwave multi-port network. So what is the parameters that we are going to use, and how this parameter is going to give us a relationship between the incident wave and the reflected wave. Okay, so going ahead, so we are considering one N-port network here. Now as you can see, so in any microwave circuit or any microwave devices, I told you, whenever we are going for signal wave input, or we want to transmit a signal, so we should have three parts. Basically, we have three parts. One is the source, transmission line, and the device to which we are delivering the signal. Now, what happens if you are considering the device and one side source, one side load, or let us consider the transmission line, whatever. So whenever we are considering a microwave network as a whole, we should always take care of the impedance matching. Now, what is the impedance matching? We should have impedance matching between the source impedance to the transmission line impedance, that is known as the characteristics impedance of the transmission line. And again, from the transmission line, when we deliver to certain device, we should have impedance matching between the input of the device, input impedance of the device to which we are delivering the wave, and the characteristics impedance of transmission line. But whenever we have any discontinuity, that is, we don't have the impedance matching properly, then what happens? We can have certain reflected wave. So that is what we have tried to show here. So what we have taken here is, we have taken one N-port device. As you can see, this device, I'm not just considering a two-port device, rather I'm considering one N-port device which has multiple ports. Now in each of the port, let us consider that we have given some incident signal. So incident wave, rather the wave which is taken from the source to the device, we call it as the incident wave. So let us write that this incident wave is written in terms of we have written this incident wave in terms of A. Okay, so just let me go back to the last thing. So yeah, so let us take the incident wave here as A, as you can see, and the reflected wave here as B. So A is the incident wave, so that we can consider here, and B is our reflected wave. Okay. Now what happens when we get reflection, whether always we will get reflection? Just now I discussed, whenever, suppose I'm considering this is my device, or any port network. So at any port, it will have certain impedance. Let us consider this as my input impedance at any one port. Suppose I am considering my port 2. So let us consider the input impedance at port 2. And suppose this is the transmission line from which the signal is propagating. So let us consider the characteristics impedance Z naught of the transmission line. Now, when we are sending the signal, the incident signal is sent at port 2, means we are just writing it as A2. But if Z0 is not going to equal to ZI, then what happens? Maybe a part of the wave or the complete wave is going to be reflected back. Now that reflected wave we are writing as B. So what we are trying to show here, that at each of the port, maybe practically we don't have a proper matching. Ideally, we should try to have a proper matching, but practically it is not always possible. So suppose we don't have a proper matching, then what we are going to get? Whenever we are giving one incident wave, we are going to get certain reflected wave. So as you can see, with respect to port, in each of the port, I have tried to show the incident wave as well as the reflected wave. Okay. Now, this incident wave and reflected wave can be shown as you can see, if I am considering any port as my nth port, a standard form I have taken that I am considering a nth port. So for that, I have written this is my nth port is represented as AN, the incident wave, which is written as the peak amplitude of the normalized incident wave. And when I don't have one impedance matching, I'm going to get a reflected wave, which is BN, which is peak amplitude of the normal reflected wave. Now, one thing is for remembering always, whenever I'm considering the amplitude of normalized incident wave, it is always associated with the incident voltage, the voltage carried in the incident signal. Similarly, whenever I'm considering my reflected wave, it is again the voltage carried with my reflected signal. Maybe the incident signal, I can just write the voltage as V plus. The reflected signal, I can write my signal voltage as V minus. Now, always we know that, so we would like to find out what is the power carried in this incident wave and what is the power carried in the reflected wave. Now, always we know that power is equal to V RMS square by 2. Okay. You should never tell that power equal to V square, sorry, not to R. Okay. You should never tell that power is equal to V square by R. Rather, you should always mention it is V RMS square by R. Now, in this case, AN, when I'm writing AN, it is my peak amplitude. It is not the RMS amplitude. It is a peak amplitude. Similarly, when I'm writing BN, this is also my peak amplitude. So if I want to find out my incident power, what is the power incident if I want to find out? So PIN is equal to my RMS peak amplitude, not peak amplitude, RMS amplitude. So RMS amplitude is going to be AN by root 2. We know the relationship between V peak and V RMS is that V RMS is equal to V peak by root 2. So the same relationship we are using here. So P in equal to V RMS in place of that AN RMS if you are considering. So AN peak by root 2 square, okay, divided by R. Now for our specification or for simplicity, let us consider R equal to 1, or we can just neglect R here because we are taking it in terms of the normalized amplitude of the incident wave. So we can just neglecting R. So what will be our equation? It is 1 by 2 AN square. Clear? So according to this, we are taking here the input power is equal to 1 by 2 AN square. Similarly, the power carried in the reflected wave is going to be also calculated in terms of the RMS value of the amplitude of the normalized reflected wave. And that is going to be 1 by 2 BN square. Okay. So this is a standard equation for the input power or the incident power and the reflected power. Now, if we want to represent our incident wave at the port 1, so when I am writing A1, that is my incident wave at port 1, and when I'm writing A2, I'm just considering a two ports I'm considering. So my reflected, my second port I'm considering as 2. So one port I'm considering the first port as 1, the second port as 2, and we are considering the relationship. Then at port 1, the incident wave, suppose we are taking it as 1, and the reflected wave, we are taking it as B1. And similarly, at port 2, the incident wave, suppose we are taking it at A2, and the reflected wave is taking it as B2. Then how is the port wave equation or the incident wave is related to the voltage carried in the wave, if you'll see. So this is the relationship between them. The incident wave A1 is equal to the incident voltage carried B1 plus, since it is an incident voltage, we are writing it as B1 plus. You have already studied this in first module, okay? Divided by Z0. Where what is Z0? Z0 is nothing but the characteristic impedance. As I was telling repeatedly, Z0 is the characteristic impedance of the transmission line. So if we'll consider, so A1 is equal to B1 plus divided by Z0 square root. So now what is B1 plus? It is my incident wave. Now if total wave at any port, the total wave, if I'm writing it as B1 at port 1, then that is equal to B1 plus the incident wave plus the reflected wave B1 minus. Okay, so where B1 plus is the incident voltage, B1 minus is the reflected voltage. Now if we want to write only B1 plus, so B1 plus is nothing but B1 minus B1 minus, and similarly B1 minus is equal to B1 minus B1 plus. Okay, now replacing these values, we can get the equation for the incident wave amplitude, A1 equal to B1 plus square root of Z0, and which is equal to B1 minus B1 minus divided by Z0 square root. So here B1 is the total voltage at port 1, and B1 minus is the reflected voltage at port 1. Similarly, A2 can be found out with respect to the port 2, where B2 plus is the incident voltage at port 2, and B2 is the total voltage, B2 minus is the reflected voltage. Similarly, when we want to find out B1, that is my reflected wave amplitude, so that is related to the reflected voltage, and reflected voltage is B1 minus at the port 1. So B1 is going to be B1 minus divided by Z0 square root, which is equal to B1 minus B1 plus, which is the incident voltage. So accordingly, we can find out the value of all the incident wave and the reflected wave at any port in terms of its incident voltage and reflected voltage. Now, with respect to this, we can also write the total voltage equation. As I was telling, it is equal to the incident voltage plus the reflected voltage at any port. Now, when we are taking it in terms of current, we are writing here is minus. You can see when we are putting it in terms of voltage, it is plus. When we are taking it current, we are taking it as minus. Why? Because this is to show that the incident current and the reflected current at any port are opposite in direction. So when we are considering current, we have to be very, very careful regarding the direction of flow of the current. And the current here is flowing in the opposite direction compared to the incident current. That is why when the current equation is coming, a negative sign is associated with this. Now, with respect to this, if we will find out the net power at any input at any port, so the net power is nothing but T is equal to, if you are taking it as the net power, the final power, how much we are getting at any port, is equal to the incident power that is carried by the incident wave minus the reflected power which is carried by the reflected wave. So as we have already got this equation separately, the incident power carried and the reflected power carried. So together it will take, it is equal to half of A square, which where A magnitude gives me the peak value of the incident wave and B magnitude gives me the peak value of the reflected wave. And as I told you, we are going to find out the RMS voltage, which is peak divided by root 2 square root, and the characteristics impedance we did not consider because we have taken it as 1. That time also I told you. The resistor, we just standardize it to 1. Okay. So accordingly, the net power at any of the port is going to be the incident power minus the reflected power, which is given by this equation. Okay. Now, what is, how to find out a relationship between port 1 and port 2, and that relationship between the incident wave and the reflected wave is given by scattering parameters. So if I'm taking, suppose I'm taking a two port network, if you are taking a two port network like this, and if this side port, we are taking it as port I, and this side port, if I'm taking at port J, then, or I can, yeah, this I can just write it as I and J if you are writing, then this side we will have all the parameters in terms of I, that is AI and BI is my reflected. So this is my incident and reflected. And here the incident is going to be AJ and reflected is going to be BJ. Okay. So when we have a relationship between I and J, we usually represent it in terms of the scattering parameter SIJ or SJI. Now there is a significance when we write I and J. So if we are giving an input at port I, okay, suppose for example, input we are giving at port I and output we are taking at port J, then how to write the S matrix or how to have a relationship between them, how to write the S parameter. So in order to have a relationship between them, we can use the S parameter, the scattering parameter as S, where the input port comes first like this SI and the output comes after this EJ. So it is written as SJI. So this gives you what, this when you are writing SJI, that means the input is given at ith port and the output is taken at J. Okay. So similarly, let us find out the S scattering parameters, the S parameters for a two-port network. Now in this case, suppose we are taking the two-port network with ports named as 1 and 2. Let us find out the relationship between them. So when we go for incident wave, it is written at port 1, it is written as A1, and the reflected wave is written as B1. Similarly, the incident wave at port 2 is written as A2, and the reflected ray is written as B2. Okay. Now, if you want to have a relationship for B1 or how B1 is going to be defined, so B1 is going to be dependent on A1 as well as A2. Similarly, B2 is also going to be dependent on A1 and as well as A2. So how to write what is B1? So B1 is my output. So we are just writing as B1 here we have written. So let us analyze this equation. So B1 is the output that we are getting. Now this B1 reflected wave is dependent on how much input we have given at port 1, that is A1, that is my incident wave at A1, and what is the incident wave at A2. So giving at 1, taking out at 1 can be represented as S11. So how it is related to A1? So 1 is the input, 1 is the output. That is why we write it as S11 A1. Similarly, if 2 is the input, 1 is my output. So here the input A2 is given at port 2 and the output taken at port 1 is B1. So we can write, so 2 is my input, 1 is my output. So this S matrix, this is S parameter is written as S12. And the input is A2. So we are writing it as A2. Similarly, when we are going for B2, so output is taken at port 2 if the incident wave, we are considering it with respect to A1. So A1 is given at port 1. So the S matrix is going to be given input at 1, taken output at 2, S21 into A1 plus S22 into A2, how it is related to the A2 incident wave at port 2. Okay, so this is how we basically find a relationship between the input port or port 1 to port 2 in terms of its incident wave and reflected wave. Now, these waves are going to give us this relationship when we write the S parameters. This is going to give us certain factors, how we are going to find out the coefficients of transmission or reflection. So that is represented in terms of this S parameter. Now let us find out what is S11. So S11 is B1 by A1, considering A2 equal to 0. So if we'll go back to this equation, so how we are finding out S11? So if we want to find out S11, this value has to be equal to 0. Now, in which case this value can be equal to 0? If A2 is equal to 0. So when we consider A2 is equal to 0, that is, there is no incident at port 2. We are making A2 is equal to 0. So at that moment, what is my S11? S11 is B1 by A1, where B1 is the reflected wave divided by A1 is the incident wave. So we can have a relationship here, S11 equal to B1 by A1, A2 is equal to 0. So this gives us the reflection coefficient at port 1 when port 2 is terminated or match terminated. We call it as a match terminated. So we just don't want any reflection at port 2. We just close it with a match termination. Okay. Now A2 becomes 0, that time we get S11. Similarly, when we want a relationship for S22, that is my this factor is S22. So what I want, this part should be equal to 0. Now when this part will be equal to 0, if there is A1 equal to 0 and there is only the presence of A2 and B2, so in that case we can get S22 is equal to B2 by A2. Okay, so that is what we have got here. So S22 we have got when B2 by A2 and A1 is taken as 0. So this is again known as the reflection coefficient at port 2 when port 1 is match terminated. We are making A1 equal to 0 means port 1 is match terminated. Now comes S12. Now let us go back and see what we want to find out. So we want to find out this thing. So we want to find out S12. So here we want to find out S12. So S11, this side has to be 0. Now when this one will be 0? When A1 is equal to 0. So doing that, we are finding out here. So S12 is B1 by A2 when A1 is equal to 0. So it is known as the attenuation of traveling wave from port 2 to port 1 when A1 is equal to 0. So first two terms, this is a relationship between reflected wave and incident wave at the same port. So that was given as a reflection coefficient. But coming to the third S parameter and fourth S parameter, it gives us a relationship between the reflected wave at one port and the incident wave at another port. So this relationship is known as the attenuation factor of the traveling wave at port 2 when port 1 or port 2 to port 1 when A1 is equal to 0. Similarly, S21, when we find out, it is the attenuation of wave traveling from port 1 to 2 when A2 is equal to 0. Okay. So since we have all these S parameters, they are associated with incident wave and reflected wave. And definitely the incident wave and reflected wave are associated with certain amplitude and phase. So what we can tell that all these S parameters are complex number which are associated with certain amplitude and they are associated with certain phase. So they are complex numbers. Okay. Now, taking all into consideration, this is the S matrix presentation for one input network, okay, for one input network where all the output or the reflected waves for each of the port can be taken as B1, B2, B3 up to nth port if you are considered n port network. So Bn, which is equal to the S matrix. So if we are taking all the S parameters, we can take it as S1 to S1n for all the S11 to S1n for all the n ports. Okay, similarly S21 to S2n, like this it will represent. So this is the final representation of the S matrix for n port network, where B1 to Bn gives us the reflected amplitude of the reflected wave from port 1 to port n, and A1 to An gives us the amplitude of the incident wave from port 1 to port n. Okay, and the relationship between them is found out in terms of this S matrix. So this is basically a S matrix representation for n port network. Now, usually we can have a relationship for all these amplitudes of the wave with respect to the incident voltage and reflected voltage, but only in this case we have to take a relationship between them with respect to the characteristics impedance. We have to consider the characteristics impedance at each of the port also. So this diagram shows you a multi-port network. So we are just considering n port, and it shows you at each of the port what is the amplitude of the wave or the incident wave, reflected wave, and the incident voltage, incident current, and the characteristics impedance. So if you can see here, so here if I'm considering, let me consider, I'm considering my port 1, okay? So my incident wave is A1, my reflected wave is V1, my voltage is, if it is an incident voltage, V1 plus. When I consider a reflected voltage, it is V1 minus, and the characteristics impedance associated here is Z01. And the current, if I'm considering the incident and reflected current, they're opposite in direction, okay? Now, we can have a relationship between this incident wave and reflected wave with voltage incident and current incident, which is given as, for any arbitrary port out of this n ports, for any arbitrary port, let us take it as the nth port. If you are writing the incident wave is An, so that is equal to Bn plus the incident voltage divided by the characteristics impedance associated with that port. So Zon square root. If it is in terms of current, so the incident wave is equal to the incident current into square root of the characteristics impedance. Similarly, this is the equation for the reflected wave, where we have to consider the reflected voltage for the reflected wave, that is Bn minus divided by Zon square root, the characteristics impedance. Similarly, for current, it is In minus into Zon square root, okay? Now, how much voltage, how much power is net input power? So already we have got it. It is equal to the incident power minus the reflected power. The same equation I have written. Now, what is the dissipated power? So dissipated power is usually a loss at any port. So whatever is the loss, dissipated means it is not giving us any efficiency at any port. Now, we want that whenever we are giving a signal, everything should be transmitted at the port. There should not be any reflection. But because of some discontinuity in the network or because of the mismatch of the impedances, we are going to get a reflection. So reflection, ideally, we don't want. But if we are getting, so we are going to face certain loss. So that loss is given in terms of the dissipated power. Now, what is the dissipated power? So the dissipated power can be given as half of Bn square minus An square. That is nothing but the reflected power minus the incident power. So if you'll take here Bn square common, it becomes 1 minus An square by Bn square. So Bn, you know that Bn by An, Bn is the reflected wave, An is the incident wave. If you are taking the ratio of them, that is nothing but my reflection coefficient. So we can replace that in this equation. So we can get power dissipation in terms of reflection coefficient. Coming for the for some other equations, so the total voltage and current at any port of this N port network can be found out as if the total voltage is Vn. So that total voltage is nothing but the incident voltage plus the reflected voltage. So in terms of wave, it can be written as Zn into An plus Bn, because you know that the relationship is An is equal to Vn by z o n square root. So taking this relationship, we can write v n plus plus v n minus is equal to a n plus v n. Rather, I'll let me write it as v n plus. Similarly, the same equation for v n also. So if we'll replace, so we can write the total voltage and the total current equation. Now, one thing has to be noticed here. Whenever I'm writing a current, it is associated with a negative sign that shows that current flows in the opposite direction. Okay, reflection current flows in the opposite direction with respect to the incident current. So that is why it is associated with the negative sign. Now if we'll add both the equation and subtract both the equation, and we will solve this equation, then finally we'll get the equation for the incident wave in terms of incident voltage and current as this, and similarly the reflected volt reflected wave in terms of the reflected the voltage and current like this, or the total voltage rather, let me tell, not incident voltage, it is the total voltage, total current, total voltage, total current. We are going to get, this is the relationship between the incident wave and the total voltage, total current, and the reflected voltage, reflected wave with total voltage and total current at any port. Okay. Now going further, let us find out some of the losses in terms of this S parameter. Since we have discussed the S parameter, we have understood what is one S parameter. So let us find out some of the losses. Now, one loss is insertion loss. So what is one insertion loss? Now, in general, you have a network, okay? You have a network means it comprises of the source, the transmission line, certain devices, and certain load. The complete thing, we call it as a network. We can have multiple devices. Now, suppose we are inserting a device. Suppose you have already done one circuit in your lab, in that you are inserting one multimeter. One simple example, one multimeter. You want to find out the current flowing through the circuit. You have connected your multimeter or ammeter. Now, if you are connecting this multimeter or ammeter, because of that, some power is getting wasted or there is some loss in power, so that is known as insertion loss. So what is insertion loss? Because of insertion of the device in the network, if we are having some resultant loss in power, so that is known as insertion loss. Very simple. So let us find out what is the insertion loss here. Now insertion loss we are going to find out in terms of dB. So here specifically, I want to tell you one fundamental thing. Whenever you are finding a gain or a loss, so students usually have a confusion that where to use 10 log, where to use 20 log. So always remember, when it is in terms of power, okay, so the loss or gain, you take the loss or gain and in terms of power. So the standard equation is, if you are taking gain, suppose let me consider I am taking gain. So the standard equation is 10 log, okay, 10 log of T out by P in. This is my standard equation. Always you should remember that. Now sometimes we write it 20. How we got it 20? Because this P is nothing but power, which can be written in terms of voltage square, okay, V square by R divided by V in square by R, okay. This R, R, if we are just considering as one or we are cancelling them, then this is what we are getting. So this equation we are getting as 10 log of V naught by V in square, okay. So these two, it comes here, and the gain, when we are finding out in terms of voltage, it becomes 20 log of V naught by V in. Okay, so always remember, when the gain or loss we are finding out in terms of power, it is 10 log of that value. But when we are finding out in terms of voltage, it is 20 log of this value. Usually students make a mistake and they're confused where to use 10 log, where to use 20 log. So this is the reason that for voltage, we go for 20 log. Okay. Now in this case, our insertion loss can be found out by 10 log by 10 log of input power divided by output power. So input power is associated with incident wave and output power is associated with reflected wave. So we can write it at 10 log of A1 square by B2 square. So in the next step, the square term we have multiplied here as I did here. So it is multiplied. So it is 20 log A1 by B2. So if A1 from the numerator, we are bringing it down to denominator. So it becomes B2 by A1. So B2 by A1 is represented by the S parameter S21. Giving the input at 1, taking the output at 2, so it is S21. So this is equal to 20 log S21. Now this 20 log S21 can also be written as 20 log S12. So this is called the symmetric property of S parameter, which we'll be studying in the next class. In the next class, I'll explain you what is that. Anyway, this can be represented like this. Similarly, the transmission loss is how much net transmission is happening in the circuit. So this is my incident, this is my reflected. Then what is the net transmission that is going to give us the transmission loss or attenuation loss? So here we have considered 10 log of PI, that is my incident power, minus reflected power PR divided by P naught, the output power. So similarly, if we'll take we will replace the value in terms of A and B, and if we'll solve it, so this equation is going to be 1 minus S11 squared by S12 squared. So you can replace PI equal to A1 squared, B1 squared. So similarly, if we'll do, this is the equation. And reflection loss, so very simple, it is 10 log of incident power divided by incident power minus reflected power, which is given by this. So again, we can substitute for PI and PR and we can get this equation. And return loss also, we can get it PI by PR, 10 log of PI by PR, which will directly give us 1 by S11. Okay, 20 log of S, 1 by S11. Okay, so this is the representation of all the losses in terms of S parameters. So basically, from this portion, one question can be expected, represent the S matrix for one input network. Or basically, a question can come, what is the basic difference between a microwave network and a normal network? Represent one input microwave network in terms of S matrix. So if this question is coming, then we can simply do one multi-port input network and we can reach up to this equation by writing the relationship between the incident wave and the reflected wave. Now let us just do one problem based on this. So what is the problem? So it's a very simple problem. Find the S matrix of length L. So length L means the transmission line, suppose we are considering, or the device, whatever we are considering, is having a length L of a lossless transmission line. We are considering a lossless transmission line terminated by matched impedance. So what do you mean by that? First of all, you should understand that. Now, initially only I told, when we have a port or a device, whatever the port or device we are considering, so we have impedance matching. Now suppose this is my device, whatever I'm considering, suppose this is my transmission line with which the signal is carried. So transmission line is associated with characteristics impedance, and this end, the device, is associated with input impedance. Now if these two impedances are matching, then complete signal is going to be delivered to the device. If these two impedances are not matching, there is some mismatch, then what we will have? We will have the reflected signal. Okay. Now, in this case, it is clearly written that it is a lossless transmission line. We don't have any dissipation loss here. That means what? We don't have any reflected ray existing here, right? So if you are giving at port 1, suppose this is my port 1 and this is my port 2. So if you are giving at port 1, nothing is going to be reflected back. Similarly, if you are giving at port 2, nothing is going to be reflected back. Okay, that means what? My value of B1 is going to be 0. Similarly, value of B2 is going to be 0. And I don't have any reflection. Since they are a matched line, they are matched with match impedances. The impedances are matching. They are terminated with match impedances. So we don't have any reflection. So B1, B2 are going to be 0. In that case, immediately we can tell that my B1 by A1, which gives us S11, is equal to 0. Similarly, B2 by A2, which is equal to your S22, is equal to 0. Okay, so that is what we have written here. So when the transmission line is not having any discontinuity, it is properly matched. So S11 and S22, which gives us the reflection coefficient, are immediately going to be 0. So, first thing is, how many parameters or how we are going to represent the S matrix for a two-port network? Now, how many parameters we will have? We will have a relationship between A1, B1, one parameter, and B1, A2, two parameters. Similarly, B2, A2, three parameters. B2, A1, four parameters. So when it is a two-port network, we can have four S parameters. That means what? We can represent it by one S matrix of 2×2. Okay, so if it is one S matrix representation for two-port network, so we can just have 2×2, that is four parameters. So S11, S12, S21 and S22 are the four parameters. Okay. Now, from this, we saw that directly these two parameters are going to 0. S11 and S22 are going to be 0. And we are remaining with only S12 and S21. So we can write this as, so that is what only I have written here. So S11 and S22 are taken to be B0 and B1 does not depend on A1 and B2 does not depend on A2. So the wave equation can be represented where B1 is dependent only on A2, that is A2 into e to the power minus j beta L, where L is the length of the transmission line. Beta is known as the phase constant, 2 pi by lambda. So when we know, whenever a wave is propagating with certain distance, its phase is also going to change, and S matrix or S parameter is a complex number since it has the magnitude as well as the phase. So we cannot ignore the phase. So we have to write here B1 equal to A2 e to the power minus j beta L, and similarly B2 is not dependent on A2, so it is only dependent on A1 into e to the power minus j beta L. So this gives us B1 and A2, so giving the input at port 2, taking the output at port 1 is S12, and this will give us input at 1, output at 2, so this will give us 1. So S12 and S21, these two parameters can be taken at e to the power minus JBL, which is into A1, A2. So if equating this part to this part, easily we can write what is the S matrix for this type of transmission line is equal to 0 minus e to the power minus j beta L, e to the power minus j beta L into, 0. Okay. So similarly, if we have n number of ports, according to the relationship or according to the characteristics of the transmission line or the device, we can find out the S matrix for the device. Okay. So thank you. In the next class, that is our third class, we'll be discussing regarding the properties of S parameters, whatever the S parameters. So today we saw how to represent one S matrix and the basic ideas regarding the S parameter, what does it give us. Now, in the next class, we will have a discussion regarding the properties of S parameter, or what are the specific property that we have to consider for S parameter. So thank you. See you soon in the next class.